Blackstone Publishing presents Death of an Altar Boy, The Unsolved Murder of Danny Croteau and the Culture of Abuse in the Catholic Church by E.J. Fleming. This book is read by Peter Berkrot. Prologue. July 2004. I was on the porch of my father's place, looking out over Buzzard's Bay at Cuddy Hunk Island in the distance, when a Sunday Boston Globe headline returned me to my last year of high school in small-town Massachusetts. Croteau files to be opened. Underneath Altar Boy's 72 slaying was a school picture like every one of mine and those of my brothers and sisters. The boy looked 13 or 14, junior high-ish. His was the unmistakable look of Catholic school kid, a particular veneer recognized only by those experienced in that particular confinement. He appeared impish, nose dotted with freckles, red hair askew. I didn't know Danny Croteau. I was a senior in high school when he was killed, likely entangled in some insignificant crisis to pay much heed. I only vaguely remembered a Springfield kid found dead in the river. East Longmeadow, our leafy New England home, was 10 minutes away, but worlds apart from Danny's 16 acres neighborhood in the gritty factory city of Springfield. His was a blue-collar, working man's suburb of a city, dominated by the mob and the Catholic Church. My crowd was certainly not as tough as his, nor were we allowed to run the streets at night like he did. Though I was 17 to his 14, Danny lived older than me. Our teen lives were poles apart. Mine revolved around a woodsy subdivision, a mother who cleaned, shopped, and cooked, and a father who worked in an office. Danny's weary mother corralled 7 kids, 5 of them teenage boys, while his father worked 2 and 3 jobs. My days were full of sports and exploring the woods with a series of English setters named Freckles, nights spent ignoring homework to watch television. Danny's days included the same neighborhood sports, but his nights included hitchhiking around Springfield and hanging with a gang of local troublemakers and thieves who drank, smoked, and did drugs. The only thing Danny and I had in common was the Catholic Church. I did recall he was an altar boy, and my parents' best friends, Don and Ann Ryan, were in his parish and knew the Croteaus and Danny's priest. They thought he was a little off, strange. Don's brother, Springfield's mayor, Charlie Ryan, was also a friend since grammar school. Their cousin, District Attorney Maddie Ryan, was another neighborhood pal. They all discussed Danny over the years. Dad's friends were altar boys, and every one of my uncles and a slew of cousins served. I served with my brother for years, as did most of our buddies. At the time, we didn't know we were lucky. The musty old chapel at St. Michael's, our little white clapboard church that dated to the mid-1800s, was a claustrophobic 150-seat mishmash of stained glass, creaky pews, and frightening statuary. It was always deathly quiet, cloaked in the overpowering smell of burning candles and another age. Everyone at St. Mike's was straight out of central casting. Father Wolahan, the crotchety dictator who ran the parish for 30-plus years, forever grumbled impatiently at us and roughly pushed us aside if we were too slow on the altar. His assistant, Father Crean, was in his early 30s, but even as dumb kids, we recognized he was a special guy. He would earn a doctorate in Belgium and serve at the Vatican directly under the Pope. A pleasant, chubby older woman from Dublin, always wrapped in a dirty apron, ran the rectory. We never knew her name, and she rarely spoke. She cleaned and cooked for the priests and a string of Father Wolahan's Scottish terriers. They were at the door most mornings and fortunately did not share their master's disdain for altar boys. They were all pudgy and slow-moving like Father Wolahan because they shared meals with him and ate whatever he was served. As they died, they were buried under the pine trees behind the church. He always paused there for a second when he trudged from the rectory down the hill for morning mass. Every morning at 6:30, always without a word, the Irish lady handed us a big skeleton key to open the church and prepare the altar for the same 11 people who showed up every morning. This was decades before priests were ever called by their first names. To us, they were a reverend father.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.